Bismillah, alhamdulillah, assalamu alaikum. That's the greeting of all the messengers. And the last and final messenger greeted his followers. Jesus greeted his followers, Moses, Abraham, with this greeting of peace. And we're wishing you that same greeting. Peace be unto you. Thank you for tuning in to another episode of The Deen Show. To check out our show times, visit thedeenshow.com. We're here every week trying to help you understand Islam and Muslims. And today, we're going to be talking about Dawah. What does it mean? Is it an obligation? Is it something, you know, I just do for fun? Is it something that, you know, we just leave for the guys with the bigger beards or the guys who've memorized more Quran or the people who are the scholars, that we just leave it for them? Or is this something for everybody? What are the do's and don'ts of it? We want to get you motivated so you know that this is something wonderful. This is something that all the messengers of God did, and you're losing out if you're not doing it. And also for our brothers in humanity, the non-Muslims, our life is an open book. We don't have no secret meetings that you aren't inviting to. You're invited to this too. Are we there to try to proselytize to you? Are we there to try to just convert you and force Islam down your throat? Or are we just trying to give you an invitation to something that'll give you peace, that'll give you life? When we come back with our next guest, we're going to be covering this very, very important topic.
Allah, there's only one God, and Muhammad is His messenger. Allah, la ilaha illallah. Allah, there's only one God, and Jesus was His messenger. Allah, la ilaha illallah.
I don't know why I did that. Maybe it's just to break the ice. Let's bring out my brother and your brother, Kemal El Mekki. Assalamu alaikum, brother. Please have a seat, have a seat. You're on the Deen Show.
Peaceful,
assalamu alaikum.
Peaceful,
I'm excited, brother.
Excellent, so am I.
Not really excited, brother.
Great.
You excited?
Always.
Let's do this, man, because this is something that's dear to my heart.
Excellent.
You know, excited to have you here.
Thank you, my pleasure to be on the Deen Show.
Alhamdulillah. How's your flight?
So it was great.
Yeah.
Everything is 100%, alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. You have your own section on the Deen Show so people can go there and see some of the other shows that we've done.
Alhamdulillah.
But we got to break some ice and we got to, you know, it's encouraged that we give gifts,
the
brother.
We give Allah gifts.
And you deserve a gift. And this is, I mean, we thought this would be a great gift. The brothers at Half Date, have you heard of Half Date?
No.
Half Date, they help do a dawah drive.
Sure.
And they have collected some things for us that we were able to get a lot more, what we call DVDs for Dawah. And you're the Dawah machine. So this is a whole truckload, not wow. A truckload, but a bag load of DVDs for Dawah.
MashaAllah, JazakAllah khair. Now, you know when the show's over, I'm not giving this back to you. Right?
No, you're not. Those are all.
Great.
So the people, these are the volume two.
Fantastic.
Yeah, so they helped us from
Half
Date to
this.
Put this drive together. And we want to give it to you and get this out, this message of peace out to the world. This is the part of that Dawah we're talking
about. Two DVDs, you've got the Dr. Zakir Naik, you've got Sheikh Walid Basuni, don't get me started there. Excellent, mashallah, beautiful. Jazakallah khair.
Wa yaakum.
Excellent.
So now, this is something that is crucial. Dawah. Let's get right to it. So little time, so much of brain picking to do. Is an obligation? What does it mean? Let's start with that.
Excellent. So let's start with the meaning. Because when you understand the meaning, you understand a lot of other things that come with it. Because da'wah, it comes from the Arabic tad'u, right? Which means to invite, right? So it's an invitation. Da'wah is an invitation and you invite people to something. So because when you look at it and it means invite, it can't be a fight. A lot of people think Dawah is a fight, it's a debate. It's this mini debate you have with people. You trap them into a corner, make them uncomfortable, and then that's it, then they become Muslim. But that's not how it works.
Like, I'm right, you're wrong, that's it.
And they
take it or leave it.
It is, like kind of a debate, but it's not.
Uh-huh.
And it's an invitation. Have you ever had anyone invite you by grabbing you, putting a fist to your face and saying, you gotta come to my house for dinner?
No, it doesn't work.
No one invites like that.
You're scaring people then, huh?
So for first thing, we'd like people to understand, it's an invitation. It's an invitation, it can't be a fight. So don't fight with people and don't try to make people uncomfortable. You're gently calling them to Allah. You want them to be enveloped in the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. So you don't want to make it a fight, and you don't want to send them away from the religion because of the harshness and the crudeness in your behavior. So that's the first thing, that's the definition.
So invitation.
Absolutely.
Do we have this mindset like we have to now convert people, that this is our duty, that now we have to make them see that Allah, God Almighty, is one, worship Him alone, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a messenger like Jesus, the last and final messenger. Is this like our obligation to make their hearts believe this like some other faiths do?
Absolutely not. Your obligation is just to tell people what the truth is.
Just deliver the message?
And Allah Azza wa Jalla would even say about His Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, وَمَا عَلَى الرَّسُولِ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغِ. The only obligation upon the Messenger is to convey the message. Mm-hmm. That's his job. It's not anyone's job to go into someone's heart and change their heart. Your job is to tell people what the truth is. All right, as clearly as possible, in as nice a way as possible, make it as understandable as possible. Then you can remind them again next week, a month from now, it's not a problem. But the point is, the rest is up to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Mm-hmm. If He opens their heart to Islam or not. Yeah. But you did your job, that's it. And you can do your job again and again and again with the same person. There's no limit to the number of times you can call someone to Allah. But that's your job. See, you know the problem is, Eddie, when people feel that their job is to change people's hearts, most likely you'll expect that they'll be unsuccessful in that. Mm-hmm. And when they're unsuccessful in that, they feel, let me just give up with this da'wah thing because I'm not good at it.
Yeah.
That's because you put the wrong task in front of you. Mm. That's not your job. Just tell them about Islam.
Now you're talking about job. Is this, as I said before, for someone who has more knowledge, someone who's a sheikh or a scholar, or someone who's memorized the Quran? Now you say, you know what, that's for the big dogs, as they say. That's for the people who went to Medina, went to Azhar, went to this school, right. Islamic Academy. Who is this job for?
Unfortunately, that is the thought, that, you know, the people, anyone with a beard over 3 inches, they give da'wah, I just sit and watch. But the truth is, there are levels of da'wah, right? There are different levels of da'wah. And some levels, you need to, like, for example, giving a fatwa. You know, that's not my job and it's not your job. The mufti gives fatwa, that's a very high level, right? Then there are certain things like, you know, teaching people in the masajid, that would be like an imam or someone well-versed enough to teach and explain aqidah or something like that. Then there's a very basic level of da'wah, very basic level of forbidding anything that's evil and enjoining what's good. This basic level, anyone can do it.
That's basic, anyone can do it.
So on the basic level, it's an obligation upon every living Muslim.
Let's hold off and come back on that point. We'll be right back.
Peaceful, 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 peace.
From the Deen Show with my brother and your brother, the Dawah Machine. Peaceful. I call you the Dawah Machine. You know what I mean, because you know what? A machine keeps going, doesn't it? Huh? It doesn't stop. Keeps going and working. You know, we try to take a break here and there, but the idea is we're going to die and the angel of death is coming. And this is a beautiful way to get closer to this way of life by constantly sharing it with others. And it's helping you also to increase in your iman. And that's like that machine I'm talking about. You just keep it running. Many people park the car, the machine, and they don't turn it on at all. But you keep it going.
Well, jazakallah for the benefit of the doubt, first of all. It's maybe not as you described it, but anyways. So basically we were saying that, because look, some people argue, they say not everyone's obligated to give da'wah, mm-hmm. and they cite evidence from the Qur'an, yeah. right? Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Qur'an, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Let there arise out of you a group of people calling to Allah. Mm-hmm. You see?
Yeah.
This ayah clearly says, let a group of people call to Allah. So they say that we don't all have to give da'wah.
Yeah. You know,
if there's a group, if there's an organization in Chicago that gives da'wah, then that takes the blame off of me. So the scholars explain that a group here is talking about the specific things, like the high levels of da'wah, that only certain people could do. But then on low level, anyone. I'll give you a simple example that I always give. Yeah. Suppose there's a guy, very uneducated, doesn't know much about politics, history, Islam, aqidah, anything. He just prays 5 times a day. And let's say he has no skill besides making brooms. One day he'll make brooms, the next day he'll sell it in the market. That's it.
Uh-huh.
So no level of knowledge whatsoever. He makes brooms and he sells them the next day.
Mm-hmm.
Now you might ask me, okay, what kind of obligation, what kind of da'wah is obligatory upon this guy?
Yeah.
He's got no knowledge. There is something, you can always think of something he could do. He's walking to the market, he sees 2 kids cursing each other up. Can he tell them, ya walad, boy, don't say that. Can he do that?
Easy.
Definitely. Can he tell his children, don't lie? Yes. Can he tell the person he's dealing with in the market that, you know, I don't lie? Or can he give da'wah by saying things like, you know, I'm going to give you the honest price, and when I deal with someone in business, I don't swear by Allah's name. Can he give da'wah like that? Absolutely. So you cannot think of a scenario where anyone in the ummah cannot do any kind of enjoining what's good or forbidding what's evil.
قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ
قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ
Say Allah is one?
Yes.
I mean, if you just know this, even that, you don't even have it memorized the whole surah, just قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ Say Allah is one. And so you're talking to people, you're delivering that your Lord is one Lord.
That's it. And the Prophet ﷺ said, convey about me even if it's just one verse. So that, are we saying everyone's obligated to give Jum'ah khutab and explain books? No.
Yeah.
But on a basic level, everyone's obligated to enjoin what's good and forbid what's evil, which is da'wah.
Yeah.
You know, da'wah isn't just specific things. And I know a lot of people like to make da'wah, you know, just walking in the street, just handing out pamphlets, but no. You know, Jum'ah khutbah is da'wah, teaching in the masjid is da'wah, you know, telling someone, don't do this, do that, enjoining good, forbidding evil, all that is da'wah. So anyone can do it.
Now, what should the main theme of the da'wah be? What is the main thing that you're trying to get across now to the people through this da'wah, this invitation?
Okay. Now, because like we're using da'wah as the general term, the scholars say that your goal is to make people more knowledgeable or better worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yeah.
That's your goal. Mm-hmm. You know? So whatever it is that will get people closer to Allah azza wa jal, or have more knowledge of Allah or more knowledge of their religion. Now if you want to use da'wah in the sense of talking to non-Muslims or calling people to Islam, inviting people to Islam, then here obviously you want to keep a specific message and a clear message that comes through when you talk. Because a lot of times when people give da'wah in that case where they're talking to someone trying to tell them about Islam, they just throw random bits of information at the person, hoping that something will stick and or something might strike the right chord and then they'll become Muslim. And that's actually not the right way to do it. The right way is to have an idea. You want to take them through a thought process and explain it clearly. But you also need to find out, you know, what obstacles they have, what other belief system they belong to, because that's your obstacle. You remove that, you present them with the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and you move from there. So it's got to be systematic and organized a little bit, not just...
Not scattered all over the place.
Absolutely not.
So the main thing should be the, what'd you say, the oneness of Allah?
Yeah, suppose I'm talking to a non-Muslim, then I want to start... First of all, I need to know who they are, right? If I tell you right now, Eddie, just outside this studio, there's someone who's not a Muslim, go speak to him. You cannot prepare your entire speech right here, right? Because you might plan, okay, I'm going to go outside, I'm going to shake their hand and give them a hug. Then you go outside and it's a woman.
Yeah.
There goes plan A, right? So you plan it based on the individual. So what if he's an atheist? You have the atheist speech ready for him, right? Yeah. What if he's someone who believes in Trinity? You have the Trinity speech ready. What if he's someone who is a Hindu? You've got the Hindu speech ready. And what if he's someone who just has no religion and says, tell me about Islam? Then you've got the speech on Islam prepared. So that means you prepare your talk based on the individual. You don't have a prepared rehearsed speech and you just give it to anyone you meet, right? And this is what people need to understand, that the da'iyah, because da'wah, there's so many variables, the da'iyah has to be malleable, has to be flexible. Mm-hmm. And you have to be able to adjust and based on the situation.
Mm-hmm. Right?
And there are many situations that you run into and you find you need to adjust your talk. You keep adjusting the talk. And one time I was talking to a man, and he had this child with him. He was a young boy, maybe 8-9 years old. But it was very important for this father to show his son that he's a man. So every time I spoke to the father, he kept telling me, you're talking to both of us, right? He wanted me to look at his son.
Mm-hmm.
So now I had to adjust my whole speech. I had to keep looking at him and spending a lot of time looking at this kid, you know? So it's not something that I would have been used to or put in mind before, but I had to now adjust my speech to satisfy that. So basically you have to be flexible, you have to be malleable, and you have to go with whatever is the situation, the problem the person has, you know. Some people have different problems, this person will believe everything you say, but I don't like the issue of divorce in Islam. Or I will believe everything you say, but there's a specific obstacle that I have. Or I'm ready 100%, but my mother is not ready for me to... So then you have to come up with solutions.
So the intention has to be there that, look, if we get to talk about baseball, football, you talk about everything under the sun, but you're not talking about the purpose of life, why you've been created, sharing that with the non-Muslim colleagues or the people that you interact with, that's a problem, is it?
It's a big problem. And how do you know those people aren't going to come on the Day of Judgment and use you as an excuse you know, for their misguidance or for their kufr, they might come and use you as an excuse. Well, I knew this man for 20 years, he never spoke to me about Islam. He was my neighbor for 15 years, not once did he invite me to Islam. So everyone wants an excuse on the Day of Judgment. How do you know they won't use you as an excuse? So that's why you got to go out there and you talk to people and tell them. Just like you said, you talked to me about baseball for 2 hours, why not talk about Allah once?
And it's, I mean, it's real simple. I mean, just when people get down to the nitty-gritty of life, and you just start to have people to think why they are here in this life, why they've been created, simple things like that.
Right.
Is this, I mean, tell us now, is this a fact? It's incumbent on every person who is a Muslim to give the invitation to this way of life. This is without a doubt, no shadow of doubt, that this is an obligation.
Well, there's some scholars who say that since you chose to live in a land that's where the Muslims are a minority, then one of your obligations is to tell people about Islam, tell people about Allah. Now, you might think, someone might argue now that not everyone is able to do that. I mean, you have to have your, you know your verses and be ready and be eloquent and be brave enough to walk up to people. The mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal is that He puts so many avenues through which you can do something. He didn't ask every single one of us to go stand in the street corner and just call random strangers and just let them have it. No, you could do it through the internet, you could do it through articles, you could do it through passing out material and not talking to anybody.
That's real simple.
You can mail people material.
Mail it to them.
Yes.
Give them an email.
Anything. I mean,
a pamphlet.
You can get that message through anything. Give them CDs, whatever it is. Give them the Dean Show.
There you go, volume 1 and 2.
Just not from my bag though.
Don't we got the 10-minute Shahada.
Okay, well, that's mostly for Muslims, right?
Yeah.
To learn the techniques.
That's a great tool there also.
Yeah, and the guy who does it, very very handsome.
MashaAllah, they handsome. Can see it right now on the screen, they've seen the cover.
Okay, great.
So we know that this is something that's incumbent, it's something that brings blessings in your life. Talk to us about the benefits. People want to know, what am I getting when I do this?
All right, suppose now I tell you, look, Eddie, there's this investment opportunity, mm-hmm. all right? But it's going to close in 1 hour.
Mm-hmm.
Look, whatever amount of money you give me right now to invest in this, whatever you put in, it's going to be multiplied by 7. Then it's going to be multiplied, the 7, each one of them will be multiplied by 100. And then the hundreds could just keep multiplying.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you will do everything to put as much money as you can before that 1 hour window closes. Right? You're going to borrow. You're going to put as much money as possible. You won't say, here's 10 bucks. Let that multiply by 70, the 70 multiplied by 100 each. That's fantastic. You're going to say, wait a minute, let me get all the money I can get. Hey, can I borrow this from you? Hey, Dad, can I borrow 1,000? Hey, can I borrow? And you put as much money as you can, mm-hmm. because the reward is so great.
Yeah.
You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiplies the reward for the du'at so much. And just the fact that you're giving da'wah, Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِنْ مَنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Allah is asking, and it's a rhetorical question. So He's really telling us, no speech is better than to do da'wah, to call people to Allah and to do the work.
No speech is better.
No, nothing is better than that.
Let's hold off on that. No speech is better, and we'll be right back on The Deen Show.
Peaceful.
Back on The Deen Show, talking about that invitation to peace, that invitation that gives you peace, that invitation to worship the one who created you, serve Him. Alone, without any associates, that is Islam. Talk to us now, some of the benefits, the wonderful benefits that a person gets from giving the invitation to his brothers in humanity.
Excellent. So the last thing we said, that it's the best speech. So I mean, you can say that's better than this, better than calling people to Allah. But interestingly, two things though, you call to Allah. It's not about you, not about your ego, not about telling people that I'm the da'iyah or the da'wah machine. Mm-hmm. or anything like that. Then, and then also, so you're calling to, but then the ayah says, وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا. You do the good deeds yourself.
Yeah.
It's not like you call people, you show them the light and you
practice
burn up.
Practice what you preach.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You practice what you preach. So like you find other things, like very interesting, how if you teach someone now how to pray, mm-hmm. right? Every time you pray, you get your reward. Every time they pray, because you taught them, you get reward.
Mm-hmm.
Then if he takes what you taught them, and he teaches 10 other people, every time those 10, him and the 10 pray, you get 11 rewards for each time they pray, plus yours. Then if the 10 go and teach their kids how to pray, it just keeps going on and on and on.
And it doesn't diminish anything from the other person.
At all. Now, if someone told you there is a stock where your dollars multiply like that, people would sell their clothes to invest as much as they could into it. But then when Allah tells us this and the Prophet ﷺ tells us this, we're like, oh, that's nice to know. That's great. That's great.
Is there any waste of time if the person doesn't even, you know, he turns a blind eye to what you're saying?
You know, that's what people think. They think that for you to get reward for da'wah, people need to convert. No. Yahi, the act of you standing there giving da'wah or sitting or whatever it is, giving that, you get reward for that. Nuh alayhi salam, the Prophet Noah, he gave da'wah for over 950 years. You tell me he's not, and few people believed. You tell me he doesn't get much reward for those 950 years?
That's amazing.
He gets reward.
Show us how easy it is. Give us some stories, examples.
Okay, I'll give you one example. And this is something basically that, I mean, just about all your listeners, inshallah, probably more than 99.9% of them would qualify, you know, could do a higher level than this man.
Yeah.
This is a man paralyzed from the neck downwards. He can only speak. And he sits at the hospital all day and night. He just lives at the hospital. So he's paralyzed from the neck downwards. He can only speak. And he brought 100 people to Islam.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, when a non-Muslim walks by, he says, you see the bunch of pamphlets on the floor there? Sir, excuse me, could you please take a pamphlet?
Now he's paralyzed.
He's paralyzed. He can only speak. He can't even point. Like I was pointing when I was saying, take a pamphlet.
He can't even do that.
He can't do that. He just says, you see the pamphlets on the floor there?
Wow.
Please take one and read it.
That should be encouragement for us all. Look at that.
That's it. So there's no way that your listeners, you know, are below that. I mean, they're able to at least move and type, send the email, do something.
Yeah.
But like I said again, it's from the mercy of Allah. He makes so many avenues through which you can do da'wah.
Yeah.
So if you feel like, you know, speeches and going out and speaking and this and that is not your field, find an avenue because there's so many.
Go out and feed the poor.
There's a million and one ways.
And then that is brought to you by Islam.
Exactly. Oh, very nice. Yeah, you gotta plug the sponsor, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Excellent. Tell us now, we're almost out of time. And again, so much things, and this is just to give people that motivation that they need to get out there and do what all the messengers of God did. But there's like some stigma. People be like, you know what? A lot of times when you bring up religion because of some other faiths, now it's gotten a bad rap. But we know Islam is logical, rational, makes sense. And usually when people hear it, you know what? It just stimulates something because it's not blind faith. How do we get past some of these stereotypes?
This is something I'm sure you've experienced yourself. You know,
yes, definitely.
All the people who have given da'wah in America, you know, Canada, Australia.
People try to think like all religions are the same now.
But if you ask the du'at, it's true. Most people think there's a stigma, there's an issue, and they might, you know, you might meet some aggressive people and don't want to hear it from you. But talk to du'at all around the world. It's a great experience. You're out, you're talking to people, you put your hands on their shoulders, you laugh, you exchange phone numbers. It's not a fight. When we go out to da'wah, university, wherever, it's not a fight. It's a good day. Du'at love it. They get a rush. And their iman increases, and it's a very nice experience.
Your iman increases, right?
Absolutely.
It's helping you to develop also.
It's like one day I said, you know, if you're washing a garment with your hand, at the end of the process, your hand is clean.
Yeah.
But you were trying to wash the garment, but your hand became cleansed in the process. Same thing, you're calling people to Allah, it's drawing you closer to Allah.
Is it true that if one person on the Allah giving you the ability to guide someone with Allah's permission, the Creator's permission, that is better than everything in this world?
It's better than the whole world and everything that's in it. In another narration, it's better than the best of wealth. But if we really felt that, Eddie, would we not be out giving da'wah?
Mm-hmm.
If we really felt it, we would never stop giving da'wah.
Okay, for our non-Muslim guests, people that can tune in every week, and we're encouraging them because they're our brothers in humanity, let them be our brothers in faith. What is this call? What is this da'wah? Give them the da'wah.
The call is basically, if you believe in Allah, you believe in a creator, that he is the only one who has no partner, no children, no relatives, anything like that, that he is one, eternal and absolute, and that he sends all the prophets to guide people to humanity, just like he sent Jesus and Abraham and Moses and all the other prophets. He also sent the prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Arabia 1400 years ago, who came with the same basic messages. All the prophets did not deviate from it. And if you believe that he could have possibly sent the Prophet Muhammad as one of his prophets, then you already have the ingredients with which to become a Muslim. Because to become a Muslim, all you have to do is say exactly just that with your tongue, that there is no God worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is his servant and his messenger.
That's simple.
That is easy.
And the reward is?
The reward is Al-Jannah, paradise.
Paradise, because we're all going to die. That's a reality.
No doubt about that.
That's not a fantasy. That's something, that's a fact.
Everyone's going to die.
Just real quick, a few seconds. Okay, some tools that they can use. For the Muslims, you have, if people want some more things that they can get familiar with. You have this 10-minute shahada?
For the Muslims, yes. Yeah. If they want to learn da'wah techniques, there's a workshop called How to Give a Shahada in 10 Minutes. You can find that on YouTube, on many other websites have it, and they have different versions of it.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people have heard that, and some of them brought 100, and some of them brought 50 people to Islam just by listening to that workshop. It teaches you da'wah techniques, what to say, what not to say, how to dress. All these things are mentioned in it, and inshallah, very beneficial.
What pamphlets do you like? Those things that, you know, will address the common misconceptions of Islam being associated with terrorism, which is something that Islam condemns, the other false misconceptions, stereotypes that people have, you know, the concept of God, the what is Islam. There's some beautiful pamphlets by who prints it, like Why Islam or
Iqbal. Yeah, they have so many of them.
And whoever has them, you know, what are some of the pamphlets that you recommend?
What we recommend is that you read the best pamphlet is based on the individual.
And the individual.
Yeah.
So get those. They're real nice and colorful. And I mean, not just because we do the show. Can I get one of those, one of your gifts? You'll get it back.
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
You also, I mean, we've gotten the best out there. Alhamdulillah, people like yourself, we're going to have you, inshallah, on volume 3. I mean, you got the DVD for Dawah. I mean, if someone has done the work, take. If it's the flyers, if it's someone else that you like, Yusuf Estes, whoever it is, if they put something together, use it. This is something that we thought we have some of the people's stories, how they've come to Islam, some of the great du'as, students of knowledge, scholars, and this is something that we encourage all the MSAs, all the da'wah organizations, the masjids to get this. We want to print more. We give these to the non-Muslims for free. We want our brothers in humanity to become our brothers in faith, and at least even if they don't accept the message, there's no coercion in religion. It's up to them, their free choice, but at least they understand us a little better now. So this is what we have. And with that said, thank you very much. May Allah, the Creator, reward you for being with us. And that is it for this episode of The Deen Show. Do that simple task that God Almighty has asked you to do. Be the best human being that you can be. You can't do that following your own desires. You have to do it by the game plan. The best game plan is God's game plan, Allah's game plan. And that is to submit your will to His will, Islam. And that's how you gain peace. It's that simple. It's that easy. And then share it. Share it with your colleagues, your neighbors, everyone around you. And nothing less than paradise is the final reward. I hope you have gotten to understand some of the beautiful things that we have said. We'll see you next time here on The Deen Show. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you.
It's cold. It's late. Everybody's sleeping. I arise and ask Allah to forgive me. Oh Allah, you see. Oh Allah, you know. All the sins I do, I turn to you to forgive my sins and my heart. I'm your sinful slave. You're my loving Lord. I'm the one who runs away. Oh Allah, guide me.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna fi khalqi as-samawati wal-ardi wa ikhtilafi al-layli wan-nahari لآيات لأولي الألباب الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار.